Hello, On World community. Tom Brown here, coming to you at the Google Plus chat room. And we are very excited to be in Memphis, Tennessee. It is Elvis Week 2013. And I was here for the last 10 years, I think, during Elvis Weeks. And we've got some amazing things planned. And this year's a very special celebration. We have some great guests that are in town to talk about Elvis and their association with him. And one of them is right over here on my left. This gentleman is a music producer, a bass player, a home restorer, an all-around raconteur guy, Norbert Putnam. Thanks for being here at Elvis Week.
It's wonderful to be here at Elvis Week.
And this year, 1973 to 2013, is a very special anniversary. There's a brand new CD set out called Elvis at Stax. And finally, they took two sessions that Elvis did in 1973, and the songs were kind of spread out all over the place during the 70s on albums.
Yeah.
They finally brought them all together, as the family should be. And you were at one of those sessions. And Elvis at Stax. Stax is an amazingly historic part of the music industry. If you've listened to Isaac Hayes and Shaft, you've heard Stax recording studio. But before we talk about Elvis at Stax, just talk to me a little bit about Stax itself. Like, what was the reputation of it that you had heard about it? And what are your feelings?
Well, Stax was sort of the equal of Motown. Mm-hmm. You know, it was mostly Southern blues, R&B music, soul music, as we called it. And of course, I grew up about 100 miles from there in a little area called Muscle Shoals. Mm-hmm. We were doing the same kind of music. So you had Motown, you had soul music in Memphis, you had Muscle Shoals, a little bit in New Orleans. But as a kid, I started playing Muscle Shoals when I was 19 years old. And every week I'm going out and buying records from Stax, you know. Sam and Dave. Was there ever anybody better than Sam and Dave? Otis Redding, okay? Booker T and the MGs, Green Onions, all that stuff. You know. And I was studying all of that because I was stealing parts from Duck Dunn, the bass player, constantly. Of course, when I played them, no one recognized I'd stolen them. But it was a big deal when I got a call from Felton Jarvis in 1973. I'd started to work with Elvis 3 years previously, and I was very comfortable with Elvis and looked forward to seeing him because, well, he was the most dynamic singer I'd ever worked with. Mm-hmm. Totally fearless in the studio. He would take a new song, rehearse it a couple of times with a demo. He's just hearing it for the first time, as we are. Mm-hmm. And then he would say, you guys ready? Well, we sketched out the chord progression and the bass line, you know. All the musicians that played for Elvis were superb musicians. We could listen to that demo and scratch out a chart. So we can play it without making a mistake. But the king would say, all right, now we're going to kill this on the first take. And of course, we're all praying we'll get two takes or three takes because we would play it once for the engineer to get his balances. And I always would say, let's do it. And the red light would come on and we would pray to God he didn't get it on the first take. Maybe he'll have two or three. Sometimes he got it on the first take. But to make a long story short, He was more fun to play with than anyone I ever worked with. Mm-hmm. Because he was going to give you the greatest performance ever, and he was going to influence your playing. It wasn't as though we would record the track, and he's going to come back tomorrow or next week
right.
and do the vocals. It was like, I'm going to lead you through this thing, you know? And it was so much fun to try to stay abreast of him, because he was moving. He was taking it up, and he was bringing it down. He was like a train leaving the station. Are you guys coming with me or are you just going to stand on the platform? So it was he was fantastic. So I'm coming to Memphis, and I can't wait to see the studio because I've imagined what it must have been like.
The magical place.
Yeah, with Otis Redding and the Memphis. They did everything live, you know. The horns would have been over in the corner, and Otis would have been by the piano, you know. And here's Steve Cropper and Duck Dunn.
Yeah.
And so I walked in. I came a day early. I flew in from San Francisco, rented my car. It was Christmas time. I had a map from Avis or somebody, and I couldn't find Macklemore Avenue. I'm looking for it was so small in the print, I needed a magnify. But I came through Memphis. Memphis was beautiful, garland and colored lights everywhere, Christmas music playing. And it took me an hour to get out of there. And I came around back of that big Stax marquee. I parked my car. I grabbed my Fender bass. I went through a back door. The place was empty, except there was one RCA guy stringing cable. Mm-hmm. And it was very dark, and it was gloomy, and it was sort of stuffy smelling, you know, like old coffee stains. And you know what I'm saying? And it wasn't exactly, I'd expected museum quality, I guess. Mm-hmm. But I went up into the control room carefully because it was so dark. I went up the steps and I peered out through that glass and I tried to imagine Otis back there and the horns over there. And it was difficult, you know. I remember thinking, the king's coming in here tomorrow night. In this dark, dreary place, can he light it up?
Yeah.
He lit it up. Okay.
Yeah. You know, you were talking before we started, and we were saying that places have sounds, and people talk about, you know, American Studio or Sun Studio or RCA Studio B. What did musicians, what was the experience when musicians would come from different places to a place like Stax? Like if a Nashville musician came to Stax or a Muscle Shoals musician came to Stax, did they adapt or what changed about their sound?
Well, I believe we brought the same game we had wherever we played, Muscle Shoals or Nashville. I had a way of approaching a bass line, you know, and I'm sure all the other players had a way of approaching the piano part. But something would happen here. I would notice after the first track or so, the playback, and these musicians are not Memphis musicians. I think in the dates I did at Christmas time, there wasn't a single Memphis musician on the date. But it sounded more soulful than it did in Nashville when we recorded with him. Hmm. You know, and David Briggs and I talked about that once, and we said, why would that be? Because you can't believe the old building is doing that. You know, are there vibes in an old building? I never believed that.
An old movie theater, too.
An old movie theater, yeah. Yes. And so, but yes, Memphis had a vibe about it that was all its own. A local fellow said, oh, it's the river. You know, the river flows through here, and it's wide, and that river affects everything. He may be right.
Sounds like something Sam Phillips would say.
It might have been Sam Phillips.
A very poetic way to look at it. What was there? You know, we're talking about this session that you did, and take me to that night. So that you were there the night before, and you're seeing that studio. And I assume you guys probably get there, and Elvis either shows up. I would assume Elvis is the kind of guy that either gets there, as Sinatra did, 5 minutes early, or Elvis gets there 2 hours after everybody else, or 3 hours, or kind of however he felt that night, which is kind of the cool thing about when you get to be Elvis. That's kind of how you can do things. But what happened? Did he light that studio up when he walked in?
Well, he made a grand entrance. And he'd made this entrance before. The first time I worked with him in 1970, I was a little apprehensive about playing for the greatest artist in the world. You know, and I thought, gee, Putnam, I hope you have a good night on the bass. You know, don't play any mediocre parts with this guy. You know? But he came through the door, and he had on his cape, and he looked like King Ludwig of Bavaria or somebody, this huge flowing cape. And he was carrying a walking cane with a silver-crested lion's head and ruby eyes or something like that, you know? And he came in into the room, and he whipped off his cape, and he tossed it through the air to one of the Memphis Mafia guys. And the cane went flying in another direction. It was caught, you know? And I thought, wow, this guy really thinks he's a king. And then he did something totally disarming. He held his arms wide. Everyone ran over, and he starts hugging everybody. It looked like a football huddle, like you're going to call a play. Now, I'm standing back because I haven't even met the king of rock and roll.
Yeah.
But these other fellows have worked with him. Yeah. And they're laughing, patting each other on the back. Elvis, what's been happening? Oh, I've got stories to tell. You won't believe what happened to Elvis. He was constantly referring to himself in the third person.
I didn't know that.
He said, I've got to tell you what happened to Elvis last week. You won't believe this. And Felton Jarvis comes over. He said, now, Elvis, we got a new bass player tonight. That's Norbert Putnam from Muscle Shoals. Hey, Putt, he says. He never called me anything but Putt after that.
Okay? And the nickname started immediately.
Yeah, it's still out there, okay?
Yep.
And so, Putt, come on over. And he, for 2 hours, he regales us with one great funny story after another, you know. And we look at the clock, and, we would come at 6, according to the union schedule. We were booked from 6 to 9 in the evening, 10 to 1 a.m. Elvis always came at 8 o'clock, okay? And then he would clown around till 10. Now, we've made one session with an hour overtime. We haven't played a note. I'm sort of liking this. So far, I'm doing great. He's the bass player.
Yeah.
And then Felton would come out and he'd say, King, I'd say, listen, you know, we really got a lot of songs. You know, you said you wanted to start that gospel album. You said you wanted to start that Christmas album. And I'm standing there thinking, a lot of songs are about that. The first week I played for him, in 5 nights, we did 35 songs complete with vocals. Okay.
Wow.
So that's what when we come to Stax, okay, he makes the same entrance. It's the same cape. It's the same walking gait, you know? but when he pitched everything away and I looked at him, he no longer had that perfect physique, you know? And when I met him in 1970, he's working out every day. He has a karate instructor with him and he's in superb physical condition. Now he's just come through the divorce with Pessoa, which I believe, and I don't, maybe I don't have the right to even say this, because you realize I only knew him, Tom, basically in the studios. I didn't come hang out at Graceland, although years later I play at Graceland. But I think when he broke up with Priscilla, it was the most devastating thing that ever happened, because that night in 73 at Christmas time, it looked to me like he'd gained maybe 10, 15 pounds. He was a little puffy, you know. And I remember thinking, I don't know if he's going to light it up or not tonight, you know.
Yeah.
But we went into the first song, and he came out, and he blossomed, and he immersed himself in the music.
Mm-hmm.
And suddenly he was leading us into the song. He was showing us where it had to go, you know.
That mood, too, you talk about, you know, where he was mentally in his life, you know, with the divorce being final, really only a few months before you guys are in December. Even as a Elvis fan growing up at the time and listening to the records, you know, I could hear that in the song selection, just in the kind of songs. I don't know if he really realized the kind of songs he was picking or if it was something he wanted to get out, but I guess the artist in him is singing from emotion, and you probably saw that in the studio as the emotion is coming through him as he's singing these songs.
One of the things we noticed right away, there were a lot of good songs coming in that perhaps couldn't have gotten through the door previously.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he had some real barricades. In the early 70s, if you wanted to get a song to Elvis Presley, it would come to one of the two or three publishing companies he had an interest in. And someone like Freddie Beanstalk would say, I'll play this for the king, but you're going to have to give us all the publishing, maybe part of the writers.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you're a strong writer and you're respected, you just say, well, I'll pass. I'll take this song to someone else. But suddenly he's got a new deal in 73, and he's paying more attention. And good songs are coming in, like we did Danny O'Keefe's Good Time Charlie's Got the Blues.
Mm-hmm.
Great, great song. Probably not a hit song, but a great, great song, you know. And Tom Jan's Loving Arms we did, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, I don't know if he planned to do Promised Land or not, because I can't imagine Chuck Berry giving him the publishing. But did he kill that? He just killed that.
That's, you know, and that's the song. One time I was with Sam Thompson, who was one of the Mafia guys.
Yes, love Sam.
And I said, you know, what was your first impression of Elvis? And Sam was a local cop in Memphis, and that's the song Elvis was recording when Sam walked through the door. And he said, that song is something I always, when I hear that song on the radio, I always think of what I saw when I walked through that door as a Memphis cop. You know, I wanted to ask you, too, before, we just got a few more minutes left. When you listen to this Elvis at Stax CD box, you hear a lot of the outtakes. You hear a lot of the studio chatter, which is this kind of behind-the-scenes stuff that the fans love to hear. What really fascinates me when I hear all of this, and, you know, you don't know this when I'm listening to the final versions when I'm a kid growing up buying the album. Elvis was producing you guys. He was telling you, hey, Putt, you know, I like that chord. Yep. You know, girls, if you'll do ooh-ah instead of ooh-ooh. You really do hear the musicianship of what this guy could do with a group of people.
Well, Elvis Presley had great ears, okay? I was constantly amazed that they would pitch him a song in the session. He hasn't heard this song before. And he would listen once or twice and go, write this one down, guys. Let's do this one. He sings it one more time with a demo singer. Oh, by the way, the demo singer, they would hire this guy who imitated Elvis's voice. See? And then they would get the demo band that could sort of play like an Elvis band. So we're hearing the guy said, hello. And here's Elvis, he's going, hello. And I'm standing over there. Elvis is imitating the guy who's imitating him.
Yeah.
It was the most bizarre. But the crazy thing, Elvis would nail that melody. He would learn it in about 10 minutes, and the tape would roll. and he would get it on the first or second tape. So he had great ears. And, you know, he produced those early New York sessions after he leaves Sam Phillips, which some of the greatest music he ever made. And he was calling all the shots, and he was making work.
I think that is one of the great things. The songs are really fun to hear, but it's that kind of material that you guys were working on, and it must take you back, too. But we want to wrap up now here in Memphis with Norbert Putnam. We are so happy that you are here this week to talk to us about this the Stax experience. And I know just yesterday you were able to go to Stax and have a listening party, and it took you back to the moment. So
I wasn't sure I wanted to go back, but I'm glad I did.
I'm glad you did, too. All right, we have another special guest coming up in a few minutes, and that is Mother Dolores Hart, who had the opportunity to star in a couple of Elvis's films and make her debut in an Elvis film. And I don't know if the people out there have any idea what she's been up to for the last few years, but I think you'll be interested in seeing it. Hi, everybody. Tom Brown here at Elvis Week 2013 in Memphis, Tennessee. Right out there over my right shoulder is Elvis Presley Boulevard. The Graceland Mansion is just behind you as you sit at your computer watching this on screen. And just to my left is a very special guest, Mother Dolores Hart, who has come from her abbey in Connecticut to be with
Bethlehem.
Us.
I lived at Regina Lotus for the last 50 years of my life.
Well, I have had the opportunity to host Elvis Weeks for about the last 11 or 12 years, and I've had a very short list of the people that I've wanted to have the opportunity, and slowly over the years, I've been able to check them off, and there was always one name remaining, and now I can check that name off. We are so honored that you are with us.
Thank you.
And speaking as an Elvis fan, we are honored that you were here to talk about your experiences with Elvis, but before we do that, your staff sent me a wonderful book that you have out.
That's right.
If you would just talk a little bit about, I love the title of the book. Can you tell everybody the title and what it means?
Well, it's The Ear of the Heart.
The Ear of the Heart, yes.
The reason I hesitate is because my partner, Dick DeNute, who wrote the book with me, we started in 2003, and he said to me, Dolores, I think it's time you do something. You will soon be too old to remember anything. And that's the best thing about good friends, is they hit you right where it's necessary. So I said, Dick, if you will help me, we can do it. And he said, I've got a great title called The Ear of the Heart. And I said, Dick, it sounds like a medical journal. I said, who's going to want to buy that? And he said, Mother, that's the first line in your holy rule. And I said, and I looked at it, and of course, reading it, Ascolta, Ophelia, listen, my son, with the ear of the heart to the voice of the master. Well, I never followed it really that.
That and, taking that phrase out and just having it stand by itself.
Yes.
But in this book, we learn about your early life and about your showbiz career and what you were able to do in showbiz and the movies that you were that you made and the stars that you were with. I work at Turner Classic Movies, and one of the films that we always have on is Where the Boys Are. And you're always there in the convertibles driving around. But these two movies, and you had a very special opportunity to work with Elvis twice.
Yes.
And if you would, and because I know all the Elvis fans that are online here want to hear about just your memories of those films, and maybe the first time you met him, or just what do you think about when you
well,
hear about Elvis?
I was in school. I was a freshman in college, and very interested in drama, and in fact had won a scholarship playing the part of St. Joan. So Loyola University was doing that, and they were very interested in having me in their play. Well, fortunately, I had the right people and got the lead in the Loyola play. Well, Don Barbeau, who I was going out with, I've got a great idea. I'm going to send your picture around to all the studios and see if we can get a talent scout to come and see the play. Well, I never thought it would happen, but it did. And the talent scout said, we want you to go to Paramount to do the screen test. Well, I thought, well, this is amazing, but it will never go anywhere. I mean, there's a million kids that want to do a screen test. I did not know that it was for Elvis, because in fact, I was in school, as I mentioned, totally involved in myself. Mm-hmm. And not giving anything else much, reason to exist. Mm-hmm. So when I did get the screen test and they invited me in to see the actors who are playing with me, I was very excited because I knew that Liz Scott was there and I knew she was a big movie star. And Wendell Corey, mm-hmm. who I had seen in so many things, and another young fellow they said, you will, when you see him, you will be so happy. So they never said his name. So we got into the meeting, and I met the two others, and then they said, and this is Mr. Elvis Presley. And Elvis stood up, and he said, how do you do, Miss Dolores? And he came over and took my hand. And I said, oh, Elvis Presley, what do you do? I'm not joking. I am not making it up. He just roared with laughter. He thought that was so funny. And then I was so embarrassed, I thought I would die. But he said, no, no. He said, I bet you're the only person that I've met in the last year that mm-hmm. did not corner me and want me to sign their arm. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, no, I don't think so. I said, but I'm very happy to meet you. And I will be very excited to hear you. Well, I'm telling you, when I went to the first, it was the first scene that he was singing in, mm-hmm. I was completely won. I could not believe the magnetism, the absolute charisma, the energy of life, mm-hmm. and the sexuality that came out of his voice was just unbelievably riveting. Mm-hmm. I went to every one of his song, all of his songs in the movie, and just sat there, even if I wasn't on call that day.
Wow, that was a great experience to be able to see him create. How was he as an actor? Because you were a serious actress. You were really, you've done Broadway and you've done movies, but tell me a little bit about him as an actor. What were your impressions in doing scenes with him?
This was my first film. So the only thing that I had picked up about acting was when I was a child, I'd gone to the movie house with my grandfather, who ran the films. Mm-hmm. He wanted to sleep, and he asked me to watch the film, and he would turn off the sound, and when the wheel came to a certain point, I was to wake him up. So I saw all these fabulous films, but never heard a word. But I saw the way the actors interrelated. Mm-hmm. After Loving You was over, Hal Cantor said to me, who taught you to act? And I said, it just comes naturally. Well, years later, in a dream, my grandfather came to me and said, you brat, why didn't you give me any credit? Because I was the one that set you up mm-hmm. to do that.
A good actor without words can express the emotion right. of what is happening. And that's what you picked up on.
Well, you asked me about Elvis. Mm-hmm. And the thing that I really liked about him was he listened to you. And he really, he talked to you like it was actually happening. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was so, really, I didn't know if he had been taught to do that or if it was natural. But whatever it was, it certainly made you feel very easy and very much mm-hmm. at home. And talking to him in a scene was like a normal experience.
Mm-hmm. Sometimes actors are just waiting for the other actor to stop talking.
Yeah, right.
And waiting to say their
waiting
line.
For
and
their,
you get
wait.
Nothing there. You know, and as an actor, you yeah. need to have that feeling back and forth like that.
Yeah.
For your experience in working with Elvis, I've always heard that on a movie set, the mood of the set is kind of dominated by the star. Mm-hmm. If the star is in a bad mood or the star is difficult to work with and carries tension around him, it drifts all the way down mm-hmm. to the grips. It goes to the camera people and the boom microphone people, mm-hmm. and everybody walks a little yeah. more. But I've always heard that on an Elvis set, he set the tone, and the tone was, we're here to work together, let's have a good time. Is that your experience?
I would not have a better word to say it, because he and his boys would walk around plunking their guitars, making cracks with one another, doing whatever games they had between them. And just, it was just like, I guess if you were home and you had kids around, they were just fun. And he was fun. He didn't play with me, though, because we had a different relationship. I was always Miss Dolores, and I kind of always wanted to see if I could break out of this, but it never worked. In fact, one time he asked me if I'd go out with him, and I said, well, Elvis, I can't go out while I'm working. My mom would never like that, because she always said you do your work and then you do your play. So I think if we could wait till after the film was over. And he said, well, that's a good idea. But then he never did.
Wow. What, you had the great opportunity to work with him on what many consider to be two of his best films, Loving You and King Creole.
Oh, good.
What, did you see a difference in the person from Loving You to a year later to King Creole, which was shot in New Orleans? I mean, because by this time now, the fame is even more. What change or difference did you see, if any?
I felt the difference was that in King Creole, he was really looking to be a good actor. In the other film, he was playing. He was more experiencing. But he told me when we were working on King Creole, because we had time, sometimes we'd have to wait in a hotel between scenes, because you couldn't walk on the streets. They were just loaded with kids. So we had waited in a hotel and then had to walk on a plank to the set over the top of the building.
Wow.
So we had time to talk, and he said one point that he really loved doing this film because he wanted to be the next Jimmy Dean. And he was really hoping that after this film, they would discover what a real acting experience he was called to. And he really felt that that was a good film for him.
You really see the progression as an actor from Love Me Tender to Loving You to King Creole to Jailhouse. I mean, that you see someone doing those things to have that career and to really do a serious kind of role. He was so talented. Sometimes the curse of the multi-talented person is they're so talented in all areas. Maybe if he had been less of a good singer, he would have had more of an opportunity for. But the singing kind of always was.
The name was the singer, and so he always had to break into song no matter what the issue.
Now, you joined the Abbey and gave your life and over to that new lifestyle choice. And you know, many people in Hollywood, they're always clamoring for the next role and keeping up in the gossip and really playing the game. But something else was speaking to you. Were you ever able to communicate with Elvis about your decision, and either before or after, and talk about that?
After we left the films, as what usually happens, if you're not in a film with an actor or an actress, you lose contact with them. Which, but I got very close to his cousin Gene. And he constantly would send me messages about what Elvis was doing and how he was and what he said, and sending me his greetings. And so I got into the habit of contacting him through Gene. And yes, when I went into the Abbey, that was about 7 years after I started. And I think I was as surprised as everybody else, because that wasn't what I really liked to do. But I knew inside it was what I had to do, what I was called to do. And many of my, Hal Wallace was furious, because I didn't tell him until I entered. And he wrote me back a letter and said, don't ever come back to Hollywood. I'll never let you work again. I mean, he was mad.
This is a producer who's produced, you know, Casablanca and all these movies, and he's just, and as an actress, you're a commodity to a producer. They invest in you, and you have dance lessons and voice lessons and horse riding lessons and all these things. You're a commodity, but you had a different idea about what was going to happen. That's interesting, and very brave too.
Well, I tell you, I never want to have to do it again. Never. But Elvis did send me the message, God bless you, and I'm praying with you, and good luck. So I was happy about that.
You know, I've talked to so many people that were with Elvis at different points in his life, and the spirituality, the connection with God and wanting to know more was something that seemed to always be there for him.
Definitely, because sometimes when we were waiting in the hotel room, he would go over and pick up the Gideon Bible, and he would open it, and he'd say, oh, and he'd read the text that he just opened to, and he would give a little talk about it. And he'd say, now, what do you think, Miss Dolores? What does that say to you?
Wow.
Or he'd hand me the Bible and say, you open it and see what you get to. But he loved that. Mm-hmm. He loved the, I think you're right. You're so right on that. I wouldn't have thought about it as deeply then because it was happening, you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I think it's true. He really was very, very moved by the word of the Lord.
And for the Elvis fans that we talk to and those of us who listen to his music, there's something about his spiritual music that is taken to a different place. You hear
Absolutely.
An artist singing from the heart.
Yes, indeed he was.
On that music. In the years that you've been at the Abbey, I'm sure you've had a lot of communications with Elvis fans. Do they write you? Do they try to call you? Do they try to come see you?
Well, they've never asked to come in because we are enclosed. Mm-hmm. We're monastic, and so it's...
There's only one way to get in.
Yes,
and that's, yeah.
But I do remember a very funny incident after I had been... Oh, I must have been there at least... I've been there 50. I must have been there at least 40 years because I was quite advanced.
Mm-hmm.
And... The bell rang, and they said, there's a little girl there, about 14. She says she wants to see you. She had met you. And I said, really? So I said, of course I'll go and see. So I went to the door, and she said, oh, hello, sister. I was looking for Dolores Hart. Does she still live here? And I said, yes, she does. And she said, oh, I just saw her in the movies, and... I want to be so much like her. And I thought maybe she could tell me about how to fix my face and, you know, to look pretty. And I said, well, you want to talk to her here? And she said, yes, could you go get her?
Oh, wow.
So I said, well, I'm not sure I could find her quite now, but I'll answer anything you want to tell me. So I talked with her for a good little while.
She never knew.
She never knew, and she never asked me my name. So.
Oh. I'm so glad that I did ask your name, and I'm so glad that you came to visit us here in Memphis. There's a lot of Elvis fans that have waited a long time to see you here in Memphis. Thank you so much for being here.
Well, it's been my privilege, and I've enjoyed talking to you too. Your memories give you, those are deepest prayers.
Beautiful. Thank you, Mother
Thank
Dolores.
You.
All right, Elvis fans, come see us in Memphis. It's Elvis Week 2013, and we're right here in Memphis, Tennessee at Elvis's Graceland. Bye, everybody.